Good morning, everybody. Welcome to St. Saviour's. There's a story told about a bishop coming to a church for a service, and there weren't very many people there. And he said, "Didn't you tell them I was coming?" "No, bishop, but the word must have leaked out." I feel a bit like that with the size of our congregation this morning, that you all knew Andy wouldn't be here. Welcome, however many of you are. As you know, most of our senior team have gone down with various things. So Andy and Mel and Maggie and Chris have had it, but they're fine. Laura continues with her problem. Chris Moyes has an operation on Tuesday. Jez and Kaz have got it. Alison Main has got it, and maybe lots of others. But we're here, and the Lord is here, and you're very welcome. This is a Holy Communion service. The children normally start outside in their groups, but they've decided to join us today, which is great. We're going to begin by saying a prayer, asking for the Holy Spirit's help as we come to worship now. Let's say together, Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. The church has gone red all over because this is Passion Tide today, Passion Sunday, when we begin to focus on the death and resurrection of Jesus to prepare ourselves for Holy Week that starts next Sunday. So as we come to God in confession now, let's just spend a moment on our own, looking at Jesus on the cross and hearing him speak to us about the ways in which we've fallen short this week. Let us confess our sins to Almighty God. Almighty God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed. We have not loved you with all our hearts. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. Have mercy upon us. Cleanse us from our sins and help us to overcome our faults. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. May God, our Heavenly Father, who has promised to forgive all those who sincerely turn to him, have mercy on each one of you, deliver you from your sins, and strengthen you for his service. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And so we're going to stand to sing two songs, both focusing on the cross of Jesus. Lord, I lift your name on high. I'm so glad you're in my life. And our second song picks up on those images you've seen and asks God, just thanks God that he has saved us through the death of our Lord and Saviour Jesus. Thank you for saving me.
Thank you for saving me. What can I say? You are my everything. I will sing your praise. You shed your blood for me. What can I say? You took my sin and shame, a sinner called my name. Great is the Lord. Great is the Lord. For we know your truth.
Merciful God, who by the death and resurrection of your Son Jesus Christ delivered and saved the world, grant that by faith in him who suffered on the cross, we may triumph in the power of his victory. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Do sit down. We now have our two Bible readings, Liz and Jeff, and then Chris is preaching to us this morning.
It is from Romans chapter 8, verses 6 to 11, life through the Spirit. The mind of sinful man is death, but the mind controlled by the Spirit is life and peace. The sinful mind is hostile to God. It does not submit to God's law, nor can it do so. Those controlled by the sinful nature cannot please God. You, however, are controlled not by the sinful nature, but by the Spirit, if the Spirit of God lives in you. And if anyone does not have the Spirit of Christ, he does not belong to Christ. But if Christ is in you, your body is dead because of sin, yet your spirit is alive because of righteousness. And if the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead is living in you, he who raised Christ from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through his Spirit who lives in you. This is the word of the Lord.
And the second reading is from John 11, verses 17 to 37. On his arrival, Jesus found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb for 4 days. Bethany was less than 2 miles from Jerusalem, and many Jews had come to Martha and Mary to comfort them in the loss of their brother. When Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went out to meet him, but Mary stayed at home. "Lord," Martha said to Jesus, "if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But I know that even now God will give you whatever you ask." Jesus said to her, "Your brother will rise again." And Martha answered, "I know he will rise again in the resurrection at the last day." Jesus said to her, "I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me will live, even though he dies. And whoever lives and believes in me will never die. Do you believe this?" "Yes, Lord," she told him. "I believe that you are the Christ, the Son of God. The Son of God who was to come into the world." And after she had said this, she went back and called her sister Mary aside. "The teacher is here," she said, "and he's asking for you." When Mary heard this, she got up quickly and went to him. Now Jesus had not yet entered the village, but was still at the place where Martha had met him. When the Jews who had been with Mary in the house comforted her, noticed how quickly she got up and went out, they followed her, supposing she was going to the tomb to mourn there. When Mary reached the place where Jesus was and saw him, she fell at his feet and said, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died." When Jesus saw her weeping, and the Jews who had come along with her also weeping, he was deeply moved in spirit and troubled. "Where have you laid him?" he asked. "Come and see, Lord," they replied. Jesus wept. Then the Jews said, "See how he loved him." But some of them said, "Could not he who opened the eyes of the blind man have kept this man from dying?" This is the word of the Lord.
Good morning, and good morning to those who are with us on YouTube or any other way. Let's pray together. Lord, we thank you for this wonderful story of Lazarus. And as we begin to enter Passiontide, we pray that you'd speak to us through your word and transform our understanding of your nature and who you are for us and change our lives. In Jesus' name, amen. A few months ago, a dear friend of Maggie's and mine called Sue Walkden passed away. She was a friend of ours from our last church, St. Luke's, and had become very close to us over the years. Her son is a Roman Catholic priest and a great friend of mine, and he gave me this cross, which was in her mother's possession, and I love it. And I think it's particularly pertinent on a day like this, as we think about the Passion of Christ. Artwork, stained glass windows, paintings, crucifixes, can be very powerful as we meditate upon them. And perhaps particularly for those who come from a more evangelical tradition where we have emphasized words, sometimes it's good for us to enter into those more poetic, softer understandings and to use icons, etc. I think as a younger Christian, I felt the proper cross was the empty cross, for it seemed to depict the end story rather better. But Jesus had died and risen again, and he had overcome death. Jesus was no longer on the cross. He was in heaven with his Father. But I think there was both a place for the cross, the crucifix with Jesus on it, and also the empty cross of Easter Day. It's easy for us to misunderstand things as Christians. The Archbishop's Lent book this year is entitled Failure and written by Bishop Emma Innerson. It's being studied at St. James's Church up the road. In her book, she argues that many ways we think that failure is something that we should avoid, and that it's bad. But she explains that actually failure is a good place, for out of failure we grow and learn and become more mature and complete people. There are other things that we bring or are brought up with, perhaps wrong ideas, maybe that God only loves good people, that the moral will go to heaven, that only some people are sinners, that mental and physical ill health should not come our way, that life should all be happy and comfort, that there is a sacred and secular divide, and that God cannot suffer. Today we think about the suffering of God. We're 2 weeks out from Easter, and it's the beginning of what the church calls Passiontide. And we begin to accompany Jesus in his last days and follow him to the cross. Too often we jump from Palm Sunday to Easter Day, and if you come here to church next Sunday, it'll be Palm Sunday. And then we hop from Palm Sunday to Easter Day, and we miss a lot. So I think this Sunday and the days during the week give us an opportunity to focus more on the passion and the suffering of Christ. We should notice that about 40% of the Gospels are given over to the last week of Jesus' life. So we miss a lot if we do that hopping from the triumphal entry to the garden tomb. We omit much of the story. And today's Passion Sunday, what do we understand by the word passion? Well, it's like the word passive or pathos. It's not so much about great enthusiasm, being passionate, excited about something, but allowing things to happen to us, permitting, suffering, allowing actions to affect us. The French word, or the European word, pathétique, conveys the idea of being able to enter into deep emotion. And think of other words with those words passion in it, like sympathy, empathy, compassion, passionate, dispassionate. So in the Bible, we talk about the passion narratives, meaning the passion of the Christ. And there was a film came out, wasn't there, 15 years ago, called The Passion of the Christ, which was quite brutal and quite hard to watch. At this time of the year, many churches have special music. There are great pieces like St. John's and St. Matthew's Passion by Bach, Stainer's Crucifixion. Many requiems are loved and enjoyed at this time of the year. But we may wonder, what's this passage got to do with it? And I was scratching my head as I was preparing for today. What's Romans 6 and John 11 got to do with it? Well, maybe it's a turning point. We're not going to go through this passage in great detail, but maybe it's worth considering this is the last and perhaps greatest miracle that Jesus did. He raised Lazarus from the dead, a sign of the resurrection to come. But from this point on, he really has to become passive and secret. And at the end of the story, which we didn't read because it's quite a long passage, we find that he goes into hiding, he moves away, and he goes to a village called Ephraim, where he stayed with his disciples. The next verse, John 11, 55, says, when it was almost time for the Jewish Passover. Many went up from the country to Jerusalem. And so the thing begins. So this is the end of the beginning and the beginning of the end. It's a turning point. And from this point onwards, Jesus is hounded, and really the Caiaphas and the chief priests are out to get him. So he has to move into a more secret place. He can't move around publicly. He has to hide and go into a time of quietness before he goes into Jerusalem riding on the donkey, which we'll think about next week. It's a time of becoming passive. A theologian called Vanstone wrote a book called The Stature of Waiting, and explains that from this particular point on, Jesus becomes more passive. Rather than doing things, he allows things to happen to him. He suffers. Those of you older will know, we talk about suffering the little children to come to me. That doesn't mean putting up with them, that sort of enduring their noisiness and whatever, but it means allowing, suffering and allowing, permitting. Well, words are easy to speak, and too many words are often said. But I think we do well to simply come to the cross and to see it as an icon or window, opening us to the nature of God. There's much suffering in the Bible, but the question is, does God really suffer? Because at this time we're thinking about the suffering of the Christ. In the Old Testament, there's much suffering, isn't there? That the Israelites suffer. And there is the exile, and individuals like Joseph, Naomi, and Ruth, Job, Jeremiah all suffer. But Greek philosophy, which was dominant in around 300 or 400 BC, and people like Plato and Aristotle did not have an understanding of God's suffering. For them, God was impassible, the unmoved mover. And the early church was very much much influenced by this thinking. People thought of God as being like Zeus, Jupiter, or Hercules, or Alexander the Great, or more later, the great Caesars. He was a powerful God, conquering, achieving, accomplishing. The idea of a suffering God was a million miles from their thinking. And the church, the early church fathers, was deeply affected by this thinking. In a very helpful book called The Suffering God by Charles Ehrlich, which I found helpful. He writes, Christian thinkers could not accept the idea of God's participation in Jesus' suffering and death, since they could not conceive of a God suffering in any way, from any cause. The power displayed in Jesus' life was the power of God. It could even be said that the love displayed in Jesus was the love of God. But the suffering of Jesus' life must never be thought of as the suffering of God. God had willed the cross. He'd willed to save man through Jesus' suffering. But he had not participated in that suffering. So the idea, those two words, suffering God, did not stand well together. Either the humanity of Jesus was so significant that they forget that he was God, or he was God, but how could God suffer? How could God, the omnipotent, omniscient, omnipresent, great God, suffer? A great theologian called Jürgen Moltmann wrote a book called The Crucified God nearly 50 years ago. And it was significant in challenging the idea of the impassibility of God, the fact that he couldn't suffer. He explained that God in Christ suffered and died. In the incarnation, we see God coming, suffering, and dying. Jesus was fully man, but he also was fully God. Just a few verses. In 2 Corinthians chapter 4, we know that Jesus is referred to as the image of the invisible God, the icon of God. Or in Colossians, again, Jesus is the image of the invisible God. The beginning of Hebrews, it talks about Jesus, the Son, being the radiance of God's glory, the exact representation, the character of his being. Jesus is like a perfect photo of what he is like. And if we overemphasize the humanity of Jesus as against his divinity, we're likely to forget that it was God in Christ who was on the cross for us. And sometimes we forget the suffering. Maybe some of those early philosophers of Greek and Roman background, or the early churches were overwhelmed by the idea of God and just couldn't conceive of the idea that he suffered, that somehow that he was exempt from suffering and pain on the cross, that he didn't feel it. But we want to hold together that it was God and he suffered. Of course, we may well know many other verses, aren't there? John, beginning of John's Gospel, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. But he came, he entered into his world, and we saw him full of grace and truth. Before Abraham was born, I am. In John 14, Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. And he who has seen me has seen the Father. We need to remind ourselves that Jesus is God in this world. And he was God when he became at Bethlehem. He was God when he ministered in Nazareth, in Jerusalem. He was God as he was went to the cross to die for us. So these 2 weeks invite us to follow God himself, incarnate in the Lord Jesus in his passion, as he surrenders himself to God, the Father, and to all that happened to him. Well, this morning we're not going to look at it in detail. There's so much that comes out of this about our own pains and sufferings, and that's worth exploring. For all of us go through times of great difficulty. And there's huge amount of comfort and encouragement, knowing that God suffered for us and God suffers with us. And in a sense, we also suffer with God. We complete the sufferings of Christ, as well as sharing in his resurrection. But just three brief points to conclude, which we might want to develop. So we're not going into detail, but as Jesus comes to the cross, how can we perhaps use best these couple of weeks before Easter? Well, first, our ears and our lips. Might we perhaps read quietly or out loud the story of the Passion as we go from Ephraim into the story next of Jesus being anointed with perfume, and then the triumphal entry into Jerusalem, and read through the story and allow it to speak to us. Read about his sufferings, Gethsemane, the trials, the beatings, and Golgotha, remembering that it was God who suffered there for us. Secondly, we need to be reminded that of all that God has done for us and of the nature of God. It's not that Jesus was different from God and he somehow was being punished by God. It was God in Christ who, out of love for us, entered into the world. God died on the cross out of love for you and me. The cross is the greatest demonstration of the extent of God's love. He really did experience the worst of suffering, a huge amount of opposition, not only from from the religious people, but the authorities. He experienced false accusations, denials, betrayals, isolation. And these are things that churches will be entering into over the next couple of weeks. Terrible physical suffering, scourging, beatings, isolation, abandonment, suffocating, and dying. God died out of love for us. Part of God died on that cross. Many verses we could look at, and just one that Andy spoke on a couple of weeks ago from 1 John chapter 4. This is how God showed his love for us. He sent his one and only Son into the world that we might live through him. This is love, not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins. It's possible for us as Christians sometimes to be very transactional about the atonement. We just think, it's Jesus died for us and now we are forgiven. But let us enter into also into what the motivation for that atoning sacrifice. It's the love of God to rescue us, to come to us and save us. God entered into this world out of love for us. So we need to be reminded that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us, and that God was in Christ reconciling the world to himself. The cross is more than just a transaction, a legal argument by which we are put right. It expresses the whole self-giving of God. And that's why it's wonderful today as a communion service, where we're invited particularly to dwell upon Jesus dying for us, his body broken, his blood shed for our redemption. And so read with our lips and ears, be reminded using our mind, and reflect so that our souls might be changed. To fix our gaze upon Jesus in the garden, the courtroom, his abuse, and on the cross. Sometimes we need to go beyond words and look at him. Allow the stained glass window, perhaps, at the front of the church to speak to you as you come up to receive the elements of bread and wine. Perhaps poetry and art, paintings and sculptures, icons and crosses may help. Silence is useful. Many churches have a service which is a three-hour service or an hour service leading up to the 3 o'clock on Good Friday when Jesus died at the ninth hour. I find stained glass windows very helpful and hymns inspiring. Maybe the other ways that we can enter into the suffering of God. And again, for today, the communion service is very powerful. And when we do these things, the response will flow out of our souls. So I'm not going to suggest how this kind of applies, really. I think if we dwell upon the cross and realize that God died in Jesus died for us as the Son of God, the response will come out of us. We will bow down and worship. We'll acknowledge our part in his sufferings. We will love him more. We'll want to commend him to others and be inspired to live as icons of the one into whose life we've been grafted. And as we know he is the suffering God, we shall find great comfort and strength from knowing that he really does understand us, for he is the man of sorrows who's been there for us. He suffers for us. He suffers with us. We suffer for him. We suffer with him. In this little old book, The Suffering God, which I found very helpful, Charles Ulrich quotes, makes his quote from J.B. Phillips. "We're without doubt in the presence of an incalculable mystery. It is so far beyond the ordinary man's idea of God, sin, forgiveness, and reconciliation that the mind is carried out of its depth and heart and is overwhelmed by the dreadful significance of the events. Once people begin to realize that the man on the cross is no demigod, no puppet, no fragmented piece of Godhead, but God himself, there is bound to be an explosion in our thinking." Returning to Lazarus' grave, here the emotions are high. There is anger from Mary and Martha, but hope of the resurrection. There is blame, grief, sorrow, and pain. And Jesus enters into all of that. His passion awaits, the passion of the cross, but there's passion here too. Jesus is overwhelmed with grief, and he cries as he sees the awfulness of the situation and Mary and Martha's grief. Jesus weeps with us today. God weeps with you and me today. The resurrection is yet to come, but the world has its sorrows. But God is not absent from us in our pain. The one who is Emmanuel, God with us, on the way to Calvary, is the God who loves us and who died for us. So in these days, we're invited to enter into the passion of Christ, of God himself. And to conclude, I'll just read a verse from a well-known hymn. "How deep the Father's love for us, how vast beyond all measure, that he should give his only son to make a wretch his treasure. How great the pain of searing loss, the father turns his face away, as wounds which mar the chosen one bring many sons to glory." The suffering God, the crucified God, this is our God. He is weak and yet he's strong. He went to the cross to die for us out of love for you and me, to bring us back to himself. But wonderfully, in 2 weeks' time, we shall also celebrate the resurrection. Jesus is now alive forevermore, but he did go through that awful pain and passion for us. Let's pray. Lord, this is such a challenging and deep theme this morning, and I pray that you'd help us just to enter into more of who you are, of your love for us, of your very presence, Jesus, as the radiance of the Father's glory. Help us to know that you suffered and died out of love for us, and you understand us in our pains and struggles. Thank you for your commitment to go to that awful cross, to save us from our sins, to show us your love, to accomplish that wonderful victory. We praise you. And may from our souls and lives good things flow as we reflect upon the truths of this gospel. Amen.
Thank you, Chris. We're going to sing as our reflection on what Chris has said, the hymn, How Deep the Father's Love for Us. And now Julian's going to come and lead us as we pray together.
Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for those words which we've just sung, that your love for us is vast beyond all measure, deeper than any love we can imagine. Thank you that it was out of love that you stepped into our messy world in Jesus. You didn't stand aloof from the pain of this world. You know what it is to grieve and suffer. Thank you that Jesus shows us the remarkable kind of God that you are. As we approach Good Friday and Easter Sunday, as we remember both Jesus' death and resurrection, please awaken wonder and hope in us again, and cause us to press into you and pursue you with all our being. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for our church at this time, with lots of illness going around, particularly impacting the church staff team. So we pray for Andy and Mel, Kaz, Jez, and Laura, and others who are out of action at the moment. Lord, we pray that you'll restore them to health, that you'll strengthen them and encourage them. And as we remember them, we remember many others in our church family and amongst those we love who need our prayers. We think of Duncan, and thank you that he's back home again now. We think of Alison and Alan and Debs, also Maggie and Chris's daughter, and other people listed on our newsletter. And in a moment of silence, let's name before God those who are on our minds this morning. We bless each of these people in the name of Jesus, that you, Lord, will draw near with your healing touch and bring them new life and new hope. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We also pray also for us as a church as we continue going through the blessings course together. Thank you that you're a generous God who shows goodness to us in so many ways. Help us to count our blessings each day and to be channels of your blessing to those around us. And as we practice speaking words of blessing to others, often out of our comfort zones, please lead us and give us the extra courage that we need. Lord, we pray that you'll fill us with your Spirit so that streams of life-giving water will flow from us to others. Please keep us from half-heartedness and ineffectiveness. Fill us with your love and your power. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, you invite us to intercede for a broken world, and so we continue to pray for peace and justice in Ukraine, in Yemen, in Israel, Palestine. We pray that you'll strengthen the efforts of those leaders around the world who pursue peace, justice, and freedom, and that you'll thwart those who oppose your purposes, who perpetuate oppression and violence. Lord, we pray for the rule of heaven to be experienced on the earth. And we ask too for our own leaders here in the UK. Please give them the wisdom that they need for the positions of responsibility they hold. We particularly pray for our politicians as they consider the illegal migration bill working its way through Parliament. that you'll lead them to fair and compassionate and as well as effective solutions to difficult problems. May all those in authority lead with integrity. May they uphold truth and justice and pursue policies which lead to human flourishing. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. So shall we say, merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Thank you, Julian. Let's stand. Once we were far off, but now, in union with Christ Jesus, we have been brought near through the shedding of Christ's blood, for he is our peace. The peace of the Lord be always with you. Let's greet one another. And now we're going to come together to sing again a really appropriate hymn for all that we've been considering and praying about this morning. Here is love, vast as the ocean.
Vast as the ocean, loving kindness as the flood. When the Prince of Life, our ransom, shed for us his precious blood. Who his love will not remember? Who can cease to sing his praise? He can never be forgotten through our hands eternal days. On the mount of crucifixion, fountains open deep and wide. Through the floodgates of God's mercy, flowed a vast and gracious tide. Grace and love like mighty rivers poured incessant from above, and heaven's peace and perfect justice kissed the guilty world. Forgotten throughout heaven's eternal day.
The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to praise you, Father, Lord of all creation. In your love, you made us for yourself. When we turned away, you did not reject us, but came to meet us in your Son. In Christ you shared our life, that we might live in him and he in us. On the night he was betrayed, at supper with his friends, he took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to them, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." At the end of supper, taking the cup of wine, he gave you thanks and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me." As we proclaim his death and celebrate his rising in glory, send your Holy Spirit that this bread and this wine may be to us the body and blood of your dear Son. With your whole church throughout the world, we offer you this sacrifice of praise and lift our voice to join the eternal song of heaven. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Do sit to pray. Standing at the foot of the cross, as our Saviour taught us, so we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one bread. In a moment, I'll invite you to come forward to receive communion. And as for the last however many months, I'll be standing to give you the bread. If you go past me, there are two trays with wine on. Take whichever you choose and put the empty back onto the tray. While you're doing that, there'll be music to help with your worship as you pray. There will be prayer ministry available, not in the chapel here, but in the prayer ministry corner. That will be there during communion and also after the service. Draw near with faith. Receive the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he gave for you, and his blood which he shed for you. Eat and drink in remembrance that he died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving.
Peace to you. We bless you now in the name of the Lord. Peace to you. We bless you now in the name of the Prince of Peace. Peace to you. Peace to you. We bless you now in the name of the Lord. Peace to you. We bless you now in the name of the Prince of Peace. Peace to you.
And be gracious unto you.
quite a lot of church family news, because the next 2 weeks are quite busy for all of us. But in a way, the most important notice is what's not happening. And what's not happening today is messy church. You'll understand, with so many people ill, we haven't got the staff to run it. We've tried to let as many people know as possible. But if you know people who would normally come or rarely come to messy church, then could you please get in touch with them? We'll have someone here this afternoon for those who still haven't heard. But if you could help us with that, that would be great. What you can also say to people who would have liked to be here this afternoon is that we'd love to see them on Good Friday morning at 10 o'clock. Kaz is compiling an Easter trail with lots of activities and participative sessions. That's always a really imaginative way to approach Good Friday. So that's 10 o'clock, Good Friday morning. Also in Holy Week, not this week, but next week, Maundy Thursday evening, there'll be a service here at 7. And Good Friday itself, there'll be a service here also at 7 o'clock. But the last notice is also almost as important as the first one. Next Sunday, Palm Sunday, you know all about palms and receiving those. But after the service will be our church annual general meeting. That's the most important meeting in our church year. And we need all of our members, that's all those on our electoral roll, if there, if at all possible. You'll find, I haven't checked, but I'm sure you'll find in the link, the agenda for that meeting, the reports on all the church organisation, and the accounts for the year that need to be approved at the AGM. This is a particularly important AGM because we need to elect between us two church wardens, three deanery synod representatives, and I believe seven PCC members. It is the committee that is in charge of the day-to-day work of our church alongside the vicar. The PCC shares in the whole mission of St. Saviour's Church, and so we need really responsible, faithful people on that. That might be you, and it might be the person you're sitting next to, but you have a week now to approach people and say, are you willing to serve on the PCC? Are you willing to be our next church warden? Are you prepared for what Deanery Synod is like? So this is the week in which you can do that for yourselves and for members of your family. We need as large and effective a PCC as possible going forward with our vision for our church. Next Sunday, after the morning service, and let's begin praying for that meeting now. A final prayer. Lord Jesus Christ, you have taught us that what we do for the least of our brothers and sisters, we do also for you. Give us the will to be the servant of others, as you were the servant of all, and gave up your life and died for us, but are alive and reign now and forever. Amen. There's no better song to end with. When I survey the wondrous cross. All my pride. Christ crucified, draw you to himself, to find in him a sure ground for faith, a firm support for hope, and the assurance of sins forgiven. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
In the name